Onto our Partners in Progress Connect webinar. I'm David Sherwood from EW Nutrition in Australia. Today's webinar is the seventh and final in our Quality Egg series of layer focused webinars. There will be other webinars from EW Nutrition in the future on various topics, but this is our last one in this particular series of layer focused webinars. And today's speaker is Dr. RJ Boyer from EW Nutrition. RJ, could you please introduce yourself?
Hello, everyone. Thank you for joining this today's webinar.
Thank you, RJ. Also today as panelists, we have Suksan Chanprasert, Regional Technical Manager for Poultry EW Nutrition in Thailand, and Kremlin Ampode, Technical Manager for Poultry in the Philippines. Suksan, could you please introduce yourself?
Thank you. Good morning, everyone from Thailand. I'm Suksan. Technical Manager, Handle for Southeast Asia Pacific. Welcome you all in our webinar. Thank you, David.
Thanks, Suksan. And Kremlin, could you please introduce yourself also?
Hello, everyone. This is Kremlin Ampode, the Technical Manager of EW Nutrition Philippines.
Thank you, Kremlin. So after RJ's presentation, we'll have a Q&A session. So the way to ask questions is to use the Q&A button at the bottom of your screen. Just click on that and you can type in your questions and we will attempt to answer all of them either verbally or via the chat box. And if we don't get around to answering your questions today, then please email us and we will pick up the correspondence later on. And also at the end of the webinar, there'll be a poll questionnaire, which will only take about 1 minute to complete. And so please, if you can take the time to fill that out, and it gives us some feedback and helps us with planning future webinars. So Dr. RJ Boyer. RJ obtained a Bachelor of Veterinary Science and Animal Husbandry degree in 1991, and later earned a Master of Veterinary Science in Poultry Science 1994 from the Indian Veterinary Research Institute. He's currently working as Global Technical Manager for Poultry at EW Nutrition, managing the global technical services with focus on antibiotics reduction and gut health management programs. In his more than 20 years of professional career, RJ has served the poultry industry in different capacities, including Assistant Professor of Poultry Science at Bombay Veterinary College, and Regional Manager, UWSEC Asia Subcontinent, and also Head of Technical Services and Global Poultry Manager at Novus International in USA. RJ, please start your presentation.
Thank you, David, for the nice introduction. Today, we are going to discuss about necrotic enteritis in layers, a hidden cause of economic losses in poultry as such. So necrotic enteritis is known to the poultry industry for more than 60 years. The causative agent, Clostridium perfringens, is a natural habitat of poultry intestine. What this means is CP is always present inside the intestine, and generally the predisposing factors that triggers the disease. Therefore, managing these factors is a key to prevention of necrotic enteritis. Though we very well understand by now and know how to control necrotic enteritis, the incidence of necrotic enteritis worldwide are on the rise. And one of the main factors for that can be the antimicrobial resistance to the antibiotics, as well as trend in the reduction of use of antibiotic growth promoters in the poultry feed. In this situation, the available non-antibiotic solutions, as well as the effective suppression of these predisposing factors, would be crucial in the prevention and control of necrotic enteritis. Among the available alternatives we have today to the antibiotics, we will be discussing going more details about the efficacy of certain phytomolecules or phytomolecule combination. The agenda today is very simple. We will look at the impact of necrotic enteritis on the global poultry industry, why necrotic enteritis is even more important in current scenario, understanding the subclinical necrotic enteritis and clinical necrotic enteritis, prevention and control of necrotic enteritis, especially in the AGP-free or antibiotic-free production, and how we can mitigate any challenge with phytomolecules. Finally, we will talk about the conclusions. So we all know that necrotic enteritis is a leading cause of economic losses to the poultry and especially the broiler industry. So almost 40% of the commercial broiler flocks are affected by one or the other form of necrotic enteritis. And the estimated cost to the global industry for prevention and control of necrotic enteritis as well as the losses is approximately 60 cents, US dollar cents per bird. If you look into the global impact, it is staggering $6 billion every year. And many a times, the losses are hidden due to subclinical necrotic enteritis, and which is more common because it goes unnoticed. So let us look at the factors or the things why NE is even more important in current scenario. We know this disease for a long time, but why? The first factor is, as I was telling, removal of antibiotics in the feed, which were effectively used to optimize the gut health and keep the gut health diseases at bay. Then there are increased incidences of resistance of the antimicrobials to the available antibiotics, especially there is also incidence of resistance to coccidiostats, and we know that coccidiostat is a very important predisposing factor for necrotic enteritis. Then among the coccidiostats, certain ionophores are classified as antibiotics in USA. So they cannot be used in the antibiotic free production. Norway has also stopped using ionophores. So that has led to increased incidence of necrotic enteritis. And then the more important is the zoonotic importance of this disease. CP or Clostridium perfringens is one of the most common type of foodborne illness in humans. The CDC, Center for Disease Control, which is a US government agency, has reported that around 1 million human cases of CP infection every year in USA alone. So that's why I think even in today's scenario, this disease is very important. Necrotic enteritis is caused by gram-positive anaerobic spore-forming bacteria called Clostridium perfringens. I will be calling the short name CP, henceforth. There are five types, A, B, C, D, E, out of which type A and C are the one which are causing the necrotic enteritis in poultry. Clostridium perfringens, as we know, is a ubiquitous organism. That means it is found almost everywhere. The spores generally are found in soil, dust, feces, feed, and used poultry litter. And as I was telling, it is a natural inhabitant of intestine of healthy chickens and turkeys. Now let us look at the reported incidence of necrotic enteritis in layer. The first report I could found is in 1986 by Browser. They found that the necrotic enteritis disease was present in cage-reared commercial layer pullets. The pullets were around 12 weeks of age. It was a new farm. All the equipments and everything was new. And when the mortality started, they found the presence of Aineria maxima as one of the predisposing factor for the disease. And they could also isolate Clostridium perfringens by anaerobic culture from intestine. And when they diagnosed the disease and added the bacitracin and amprolium in the feed, the mortality was normalized. The interesting fact was what they noticed is you can see in the feeder the flies, the house flies, dead house flies. And they concluded that the flies population was very high, and those flies resulted in the dead flies mixed with feed went into the they are eaten by the birds, and birds were suffered from necrotic enteritis. Similarly, in 2004, Dillon et al. They also reported that flies in the poultry houses act as mechanical transmitters of Clostridium perfringens, and that the development of necrotic enteritis was by ingestion of these bacteria present in the flies and their secretions. So looks like the mechanical vectors, they were the main cause in the cage-reared birds. Then there are also reports of cases of necrotic enteritis in floor pens, in cage system, as well as in cage-free layers. Especially, there is a rise in certain countries in the cage-free egg production. And since these birds are not confined, they are exposed to coccidiosis. And we will see in the subsequent slides how coccidiosis allows the overgrowth of Clostridium perfringens in the intestine. Generally in layers, the sick birds show depression, ruffled feathers, eyes are generally closed, lameness, paralysis, dark color diarrhea, and there may or may not be problems of eggshell quality and reduced egg production. So let us look at necrotic enteritis at a glance. The predisposing factors. Dysbiosis is the principal predisposing factor. Dysbiosis or dysbacteriosis, we call it as disturbance in the ecosystem of the intestine. Coccidiosis, even the mycotoxicosis, salmonellosis, and some of the anti-nutritional factors in the feed. They are the key predisposing factor. I will go in details of these predisposing factors in the subsequent slide. The main damage is caused by toxins. Alpha and net B toxins are the main one, which causes damage to the small intestine, produces liver lesions and mortality. Affected age and duration, generally the disease, the duration of the disease is 2 to 5 days. Layer pullets raised in cages generally when they are going towards the transfer of the pullets and then going towards the pig egg production. That's the age when it affects more in the layers. And in broilers, it is around 2 to 4 or 5 weeks, and turkeys 7 to 12 weeks. Mortality might be somewhere around as low as 2%, and it can go as high as 50%. Depends upon the severity of the infection. Now let us look at the predisposing factors one by one. This is very important to control the predisposing factors to keep the disease at the bay. The first thing is there are several factors related to feed. It may be high protein or high use of low digestible protein feeds, ingredients, and higher use of fat in the diet. Then anti-nutritional factors, for example, the non-starch polysaccharides, which has impact on the viscosity of the ingesta. They can cause the issue. Then mycotoxins, especially the DON produced by Fusarium. This Fusarium, then the second factor is Imeria. This is one of the, I think, prerequisite for the development of necrotic enteritis. The Imeria grow intracellularly and cause lysis of epithelial cells of intestine, and finally results in the availability of nutrients for the massive proliferation of Clostridium perfringens. Due to coccidiosis, the perforations are made in the intestinal epithelial lining, and the plasma proteins are utilized as a substrate by Clostridium perfringens. And then this leads to the development of the disease. The third important factor is stress. And this, there can be a different kind of stressors during the entire life of the birds, especially the transport of hens to the laying farms, different feed changes, and weather conditions, especially the heat stress. The heat stress can lead to an alteration in the intestinal epithelium integrity as well as microbiota, which could disturb the intestinal ecosystem and leads to the enteritis. The removal of antibiotics or ban on use of antibiotics. We have talked about that. And also we have talked about the presence of insects or flies in the high number. These insects act as vector and mechanical transfer of bacteria near to the birds. It is also important to understand some normal but unusual facts of poultry. The normal poultry intestine involves reflex back and forth. So the bile empties in the jejunum somewhere here, but you can find the bile in gizzard. So that proves that there is a constant reflux back and forth. So cecal contents can also reflux back into the intestine. This ceca, which are the natural habitat of Clostridium perfringens, and then the CP, Clostridium perfringens, they can leave ceca and migrate to the upper intestine. Increase in CP count or number in ceca increases the chances of the colonization of Clostridium perfringens in the duodenum. And most important thing we need to understand is that the alteration in the duodenal environment is necessary for the colonization of Clostridium perfringens, which has traveled all the way from Sika. And what are those alterations? It is the dysbacteriosis, alterations caused by coccidiosis, damage by mycotoxins, or even the effect of anti-nutrients in the feed. Symptoms of subclinical and clinical necrotic enteritis. In subclinical necrotic enteritis, it is symptoms generally goes unnoticed. There might be reduction in the feed intake, the reduced performance sometime, but there will be never a peak mortality. That's why it's more dangerous from economic point of view. In clinical, as I was telling you, the birds become, they don't want to move, the feathers are ruffled, there is depression, and generally in clinical NE, you see high mortality and dark color diarrhea, and also bird don't want to eat feed as it eats normally. If you look at the lesions, we generally found the lesions in small intestine. The gross lesions are primarily found in jejunum and ileum. And what you see is that generally the intestine is ballooned because it's a gas-producing organism, friable, and contain a foul-smelling brown fluid. The mucosa is usually covered with a tan or yellow pseudomembrane. You can see here. And it is often referred as Turkish towel appearance. And this pseudomembrane, depending upon the severity, may extend throughout the small intestine. Now, lesion scoring is very important when you want to decide what treatment you want to give or look at the severity of the infection. There are several methods or scores, like from 0 to 6. I'm here giving one example of 1 to 4 score. So mostly the lesion scoring is done in duodenum and ileum. So here in the first picture, you can see the congested intestinal mucosa. This is generally found in subclinical necrotic enteritis. And then in figure 2, 3, and 4, varying level of focal necrosis and ulcerations. So it depends upon the number of the foci. And then the final last score, which is the most diffuse form of necrosis, necrotic necrosis, this is more typical of the field cases. It looks like the Turkish towel appearance. So, though we know about the prevention and control of necrotic enteritis, there are challenges. First thing is the disease progresses very fast. It doesn't give you much time. And the toxins, the alpha and net B, they produce irreversible intestinal damage. That means even after the treatment, the things cannot be normal as they were. And it is often challenging to effectively use antibiotics. And one more thing, where the withdrawal or the residues of the antibiotics in eggs are not allowed. And since many antibiotics leave residues in eggs, that there needs a withdrawal period. and this results in further loss to the producer, egg producers, as these eggs cannot be sold. So better is prevention. So most important aspect of prevention is managing the feed quality, especially the protein quality and quantity. There are certain enzymes, protease enzymes, that can help with managing the use of higher undigestible protein containing ingredients. Mycotoxin risk management also a very important thing in the prevention. And then also various use of various feed enzymes to counter anti-nutritional factors and improve the digestibility. Farm management, it is utmost important to minimize the all kind of stresses. And when the stresses are unavoidable, managing those stresses with the different practices. Keeping the insects and flies population at minimum. Then for prevention and control, wherever the antibiotics can be used, we all know that AGPs like virginiamycin, bacitracin, lincomycin can help by addition of these, any of these in the feed. In the treatment, again, bacitracin, penicillin, lincomycin, these kind of antibiotics, they are given through the drinking water. Most important thing in the treatment of necrotic enteritis is simultaneous treatment of coccidiosis, which is often needed. Then in the condition that the farmer or the company do not want to use antibiotics, or there is a legislative ban on the use of certain antibiotic growth promoters, I think in that situation, there are several studies available that phytomolecules or essential oils, probiotics, prebiotics, and butyrates, sometimes minerals, they form the part of the prevention program. But the most important thing here, like the non-antibiotic alternatives like probiotics, they can prevent. But what you can do when there is a clinical necrotic enteritis, what alternatives we have if we do not want or cannot use the antibiotics. So I think I will go more details into those. I think phytomolecules based solutions, they are one of the reason. And here, one of the alternative to take on more severe cases of necrotic enteritis. These phytomolecules, some of the phytomolecules, they have the antimicrobial effect, which we can call here as bacteriostatic effect, like cinnamaldehyde and carvacrol. But phytomolecules take the more holistic approach. It is not only the bacteriostatic effect, but for example, they improve the digestion. There are certain phytomolecules like capsaicin, which is from Chile. This pungent phytomolecule promotes the digestion of feed ingredients. This is caused by an increased secretion of the endogenous digestive enzymes, as well as increased peristalsis. So the feed undergoes a better mixing in gastrointestinal tract and is better utilized by bird, and nothing is left much for the proliferation of Clostridium perfringens. As I was telling, phytomolecules like cinnamaldehyde also have a very beneficial effect on the tight junction integrity. They help to keep the gut membrane intact and thus preventing the leaky gut, which we commonly hear. And further, prevention of leaky gut results into the stoppage or reduced flow of bacteria and their toxins from gut lumen into the bloodstream, and the CP can be mitigated. This antimicrobial activity or bacteriostatic activity of certain phytomolecules can prevent overgrowth of other opportunistic pathogens and then reducing the frequency of dysbiosis and diseases like necrotic enteritis. How the phytomolecules generally have this bacteriostatic effect, there is a phenomenon called quorum sensing. Through this quorum sensing, the bacteria, they communicate within their population as well as other bacterial population. And then this communication, depending upon this communication, they decide to proliferate or to reduce their numbers and survival, struggle for the survival or make attack. So there is a phenomenon opposite to that is called as quorum quenching. And these phytomolecules, they act through those phenomena where they block this communication between the bacterial populations. So they don't get those messages and the population remains static or it reduces. Then also some of the phytomolecules have the antioxidant effect, which is very helpful in relieving the different stresses. Then the select phytomolecules are effective against Clostridium perfringens. So I am showing here the results of a in vitro trial where three Clostridium perfringens type reference strains were compared in their sensitivity to phytomolecules. One of the phytomolecule preparation was used for that, which contains carvacrol and cinnamaldehyde. The trial demonstrated the bactericidal and growth inhibiting effect of the specific combination of select phytomolecules against Clostridium perfringens. So here you can see these three different strains, reference strains of Clostridium, and then four different concentrations of this particular combination. The results were shown like minus signs, that means no effect. Then one plus sign is a growth inhibition effect, and then the bactericidal effect. So what you can see is that this particular combination, even in a very small, not very concentrated form, is having the growth inhibition effect and bactericidal effect also. Generally, in the phytomolecules, the formulation doesn't aim for bactericidal effect, but it is the bacteriostatic effect. So these combination, these concentrations are not use in this concentration is not generally recommended by the supplier of the phytomolecule preparations. But it is the, even in the low concentration, they should be able to achieve the growth inhibition effect. That's how I think it has a profound effect, unlike antibiotic, on the maintaining the ecosystem of the intestine of the birds. There is one more study with this phytomolecule combinations. This is a scientific study done with the necrotic enteritis challenge. The study was done at USA with the male Cobb 500 broilers. It was a 42-day study. The feed used was pelleted and no coccidiostat was added, which is important to have a predisposing condition like coccidiosis to experimentally develop this disease. It is very hard to develop experimentally. In this study, the defined oral challenge with Clostridium perfringens was given on day 19, 20, and 21. The concentration of this, the titration levels were approximately 10 to the power 8 to 9 colony-forming units. And the strain used was the field strain of Clostridium perfringens. Different treatments were negative control, that means no challenge, no treatment. Then the positive control was with necrotic enterotic challenge, but no additives. The third group was with this phytomolecule combination, which is used for feed. And then the fourth treatment was the phytomolecule combination in feed as well as in drinking water. These two combinations are not exactly the same, the formulations. There are certain differences. So it was applied at, so in the feed, it was from day 1 to 42, but in the water, in two different doses. First dose was 250 ml per 1000 liter water from day 12 to 14, and it was for 24 hours per day. The second dose was between 19 to 21 days, which were the challenge days. And the dose here was 500 ml to counter the challenge. But the dose was only for 16 hours. So basically the 8 hours were skipped, 4 hours before challenge and 4 hours after challenge. Now, on day 21, the three birds from each pane were examined for degree of presence of necrotic enteritis lesions. And the lesion scoring was based on 0 to 3 score. So basically 0 being for normal intestine, 1 for slight mucus covering and loss of tone, 2 for severe necrotizing enteritis, and 3 for extreme necrotizing enteritis. So what lesion score indicated that in the positive control, which received only the challenge, no treatment, the lesion score was between 1.5 to 2. So we could actually create the disease, clinical necrotic enteritis. What we see is that both the treatment, which the result were not significantly different, the lesion score was well below 1. So it was between 0 to 1. So that means near normal to the slight mucus covering we could found here. But in this case, there was lesions of necrotization. So this combination, phytomolecules combination, they do were helpful in reducing the lesions. Similarly, the most important effect was on mortality. When this liquid combination was used along with powder, there was a significant reduction in mortality. And this was a proof of concept for this phytomolecule liquid combination that it acts fast and helps to achieve the concentration of the phytomolecules in the intestine faster to exhibit the antimicrobial effect. So you could see that it can actually reduce the mortality. And the treatment was only for limited period. If, let's say, the treatment went longer, the liquid treatment, then it would have reduced mortality even more than that. Now let us look into the stressful events that may lead to dysbacteriosis in case of layers. and that leads to wet or loose droppings. Now we can see that in this red square, this is the one of the most critical period in the life of the layer birds. It starts from week 14 and extends up to week 36, where the birds attain the peak production. Lot of events occur during this period. So for example, three feed changes: the pre-lay feed, then pre-picking feed, and then picking feed. So three changes. Then the transfer of grower from grower house to layer house. So generally the flocks are moved at the age of 15 to 16 weeks. And also most of the layer farmers, they take utmost precaution. They know that this is a stressful period, and they try to manage with vitamins, probiotics, vitamin C, etc. Generally for 6 days, 3 days before the transfer and 3 days after the transfer, this goes on. But still, there are incidences that there is a loss in body weight, like around 100 grams per bird in case of some birds. And of course, this loss get recovered if you have proper conditions, good management, feed within a week. But what I am trying to say here is that this is the most stressful period. Here, the production increases rapidly. It is also the egg size also increases, and also the body weight increase. So generally, what we have seen is that this is the period when the dysbiosis happens because of the many factors. And generally, you can see the loose dropping or wet dropping, and the conditions are severe, then subclinical enteritis, necrotic, and then clinical necrotic enteritis can also be found. So what we have observed in one of the field validation, that the phytomolecules exhibited fast improvement in feces consistency when a specific combination was applied. The issue was wet feces, you can see here, and undigested feed particles, you can see here. And this issue was in broiler breeders when they were going towards the peak production, attending the peak. So this specific phytomolecule combination was applied for 5 days, 8 hours a day. That was the period. And you can clearly see that day by day, there is a clear-cut improvement in the consistency of the feces. And by the fifth day, you see difference between the before application, and by fifth day, it were perfectly normal. I think a picture can tell us a lot. In the same, this was in one house, then it was repeated in the another house where the problem was not that severe like the first one. But you can see that every day you can see the improvement. So within 5 days, the feces consistency became normal. That means the dysbacteriosis was taken into control. This is my last slide. And based on the discussion we have so far, I think what we can conclude is necrotic enteritis is one of the most common enteric disease of poultry birds, including layers, resulting in the significant economic losses. Out of the two forms, the subclinical necrotic enteritis generally go unnoticed, and it is popularly known as hidden profit killer. It doesn't show the appearance, but it is masked. Then we are seeing the increased incidence of necrotic enteritis worldwide, and mainly due to the antimicrobial resistance to the available antibiotics or antimicrobials, and reduced use of antibiotic growth promoter. That is a very strong trend. If your country do not have those regulations, but this is coming due to the tremendous pressure of the consumers as well as the regulatory bodies. And in the situation like this, when we do not have the alternatives, we cannot use the antibiotics, then the phytomolecules, not all, but certain phytomolecules combinations, specific formulations can prevent and control both subclinical and clinical necrotic enteritis. Thank you very much for your patience listening, and I will hand over to the host, David, and as well as my other panel member friends to answer the questions that the participants might have posted. David.
Thank you, Ajay, for a very good overview of that topic. We're all very familiar with NE in relation to broilers, but as you've highlighted so well, it's also can be a problem in layers as well. So please send in your questions to the Q&A box, and bear with us as we look through the list of questions you're sending through, and we will answer them.
So the first question that from Hafiz, that what is the best an ideal for non-antibiotics alternative to control and treat for necrotic enteritis in layer. In my opinion, so treatment would be the last choice if you face the problem of necrotic enteritis. You always use the antibiotic to treat it first, right? But we focus with the preventive or control necrotic enteritis by use the alternative antibiotics such as phytogenic products or plant extract product to use as a prevention strategies. In our experience in layer, I always found the necrotic enteritis in layer during the point of lay to peak period. I always found a problem during that time. I apply phytogenic products, right, to control in feed, starting from like probably around 18 weeks until the peak period, right? And after we apply this program, we see with very good response in terms of egg production, right? Less problem of wet droppings from necrotic enteritis, right? We always use this program during that time, right? Thank you.
Yeah, so I will take next question. The question is, why you only specify Fusarium and Dawn as the only predisposing mycotoxins for NE? Actually, I don't wanted to say that this is the only predisposing mycotoxin, but if you look into the specific, this Dawn, which has a cytotoxic effects on the neutrophil of the intestine in a very small dose, means That is why I thought that this particular toxin is more important as far as the predisposing factor is concerned. Of course, all the mycotoxins, we know that they hamper the immunity, and it is not only the necrotic enteritis, but also they are the predisposing factors for other infections. Then I think the next question is, why mucus layer attracts Clostridium perfringens? So basically, mucus, if you look into the composition of mucus, it is made up of high concentration of proteins. And this protein is utilized as a nutrient for the proliferation by Clostridium perfringens. Sukhsan, do you want to take any question?
Yes. I take one question. The question is, could phytomolecule be used for treatment of necrotic enteritis, right? So actually, as I mentioned, when you found the problem of necrotic enteritis occur, that sometimes the farmer use antibiotics such as bracitracin, lincomycin, or ampicillin, right, for 3 or 4 days, right, and followed by phytomolecule. That's why they did that application, because they use antibiotic to control for the high incident, high challenge, and then followed by phytomolecule, like to control for some of the Clostridium that's already resistant to antibiotic, something like that. But actually, phytomolecule can be used as treatment, but in high dosage, right? So we recommend, as I mentioned, we recommend for prevention better than treatment. Right. All right, AJ, any?
Yeah. So then there was a question related to if we are allowed to use antibiotics, then can we use phytomolecules along with antibiotics? Are there any antagonism? There are no known antagonism, especially with the phytomolecules we have mentioned here, with not only with antibiotics, but even with the other substances, because phytomolecules are originated from the natural source, or they are like natural. So I think the most important thing when you apply two products through drinking water is to ensure that one doesn't cause the sedimentation of other. So that's the main thing. And I think if you go give antibiotics and the phytomolecules together, probably phytomolecules might help to establish the microflora balance, which we know that antibiotics generally disturb. They kill the bacteria, sometimes good and bad together. Sukhsan, do you have any other question to take?
Yes. The other question is the products thermostable or not? And can you add also in a batch mixer or post palleting using sprayer or effect in higher by adding in drinking waters, right? So in this question, so in terms of the product application from EW division, we have two forms of phytogenics product. The first one, the form of in-feed form, right? In feed form, the product is for sure is thermostable and has a property of slow releasing property also to control necrotic enteritis or Clostridium to entire the gastrointestinal tract. So in feed, we suggest to use the the infant form, right? And for infant, we would suggest liquid form, right? We are drinking waters because this one is like really, is considered as a very fast acting property to control the high challenge period during the growing or during the production period. We suggest liquid to use on farm and suggest dry form to use in feed, right? So we don't have any application to use liquid form spray after pelleting. No, we don't have this application. Thank you.
There is a question about the relationship of calcium as a predisposing factor of necrotic enteritis. Yes, too much use of calcium in the diet may cause also as a cause of necrotic enteritis in layer. So that's why too much or excessive use of this of calcium should be monitored, should be in particular in a diet for you to avoid this kind of a disease. So that's it.
So there is a question. It has been mentioned the importance of alternative treatment for coccidiosis. What about diarrhea caused by E. coli? Is it also a major cofactor or not always? So since this was the presentation related to necrotic enteritis, I focused on the effect of phytomolecules on Clostridium perfringens. But that doesn't mean that these phytomolecules are not effective against other bacteria like E. coli. There are studies that shows the efficacy against E. coli, Salmonella, those kind of enteric pathogens. So yeah, it is also equally effective on other enterites. And if I understood this question correct, is it a major cofactor for necrotic enteritis? I think we have to look from the point that if E. coli has taken upper hand in the disease creation, then their population is high and there may not be the accommodation for Clostridium perfringens to proliferate to cause the disease. But definitely it's a kind of enteritis, and it depends upon the dynamics of the microflora, whether it can subsequently result into necrotic enteritis or not.
Okay, we probably have time for about two more questions, I think.
Yes, David. So there is one more question, at which age of layers we can start program to prevent from any. So I think if we look specifically into the layers, and we have seen that there are certain weeks in the life where the danger is more, I think anticipating that danger and starting the program well before the problem surfaces, that's the best time. So generally, it is recommended that if you are not using antibiotic growth promoters, you start using the phytomolecule preparation intended for feed from day one, so that the different challenges, you know, even the chicks also face the stressors like different vaccinations, feed changes, and so on. So I think the answer is you can start from day one, and then this liquid can be applied when you anticipate the stress or dysbacteriosis, or when you see actually the loose dropping, then for 3 days or 5 days, depending upon severity, the dose can also be reduced or increased.
So the next question from Hafiz is how much of any necrotic enterotoxic effect to egg production and egg quality, right? So in my experience in field with the layer farmer, so actually the egg production performance drop depend on how much of the challenge in that farm, starting from 5% to like nearly 50% that I have seen before. And also effect to egg quality also in terms of like egg yolk and egg white, effect to whole unit, the egg weight, egg mass also, we can see that the problem from necrotic enteritis.
David, there is one interesting question, if you allow me to answer for 1 minute. Can we use phytomolecules and acidifiers simultaneously? Or what happens if the water acidifier is used? The answer is yes, you can use simultaneously because the mode of action is independent. And in water, what happens? The organic acids, if you are using organic acids for water acidification, they improves or increases the effectivity of certain phytomolecules like cinnamaldehyde. There are reports in the literature that organic acid increases the antimicrobial activity of cinnamaldehyde.
Okay, thank you very much, Ajay, Kremlin, and Suksant. That was great. And also thank you all for attending and for your questions. And as I said, if we haven't not been able to answer your question today, please email us at webinar@ewnutrition.com and we will get back to you with answers on that. And also there'll be a recording of this webinar tomorrow on our website. And pretty soon I'll launch the poll. So please, if you can, take the time to complete that. And I hope you've enjoyed our Quality Egg series of layer webinars. I hope it's been useful for your work and your studies. As I said, there will be other webinars from EW Nutrition on various topics in the future as well. So thank you and goodbye.